So, is it worth it? This is what you really want to know, isn't it? I'm afraid to say you're going to have to watch this review to find out. The real answer? It depends on what you're going to do with it. GBLS is a South Korean manufacturer who is noticeably new to the industry of airsoft, and as a company, has decided to innovate past the norms of what is expected in the technological norms of today's airsoft market. The Dynamic Action System, otherwise known as the DAS, is a new mechanical system which simulates the reciprocation of a moving bulk carrier group without the use of gas propulsion. This system works with a split gearbox of one main gear that reciprocates the bolt carrier backwards, not only creating a recoiled effect, but also compressing the spring in the bolt and chambering a new BB. GBLS have released three different iterations of the DAS airsoft rifles, which has led to the third iteration being the GDR-15 production release edition. This iteration is supposed to be consumer ready, with all the expected features and performance requirements to skirmish alongside other AEG rifles. Needless to say, the issues advertised and voiced by media outlets about the older models have mostly been addressed, if not completely resolved. If you hadn't noticed, the DAS GDR-15 comes complete with PTS furniture, not only increasing the ergonomics and look of the product, but also increasing the value of the product being purchased. The GDR-15 comes with a PTS-enhanced polymer stock, which also houses the battery compartment and wiring. The EPS is a fairly ergonomic stock with a cheek weld on both sides and a streamlined adjustment lever for multiple positional adjustments. The rubberized pad assists with shoulder seating of the rifle and securely retains itself with the help of two notches on either side of the stock. On both sides of the stock, there are two universal quick detach sling attachment points, which securely retain QD attachments. We recommend using real QD sling attachments as clones have bad tolerances which could lead to loss of retention. Bear in mind that the stock tube accepts mil-spec stocks and could potentially accept some AEG stocks with some modification. The battery compartment has room for dual stick LiPo batteries, and don't forget that this rifle is wired to mini Deans. It is recommended that an 11.1 volt high current battery be used to get the best performance out of the DAS GDR-15. The upper and lower receiver is cerakoted with a non-ambidextrous fire selector and GBLS trades on one side. The charging handle, bolt catch, and trigger are nothing substantial. However, they are very well made and have had little to no wear over the course of stress testing this product. The pistol grip is the PTS enhanced polymer grip, which is not only rubberized but uses small textured stippling to help with hand grip in wet situations. The use of the beaver tail also adds grip and assists with getting a high position with the nape of the thumb. The fire selector has three positions at 90 degree positions, which click into position very securely. On the other side of the receivers, you can find a working forward assist for the bolt carrier and a magazine release. There are little to no trays on the side of the rifle, and the dust cover opens as the bolt reciprocates for realistic action. The magazine seats in the rifle securely and has little to no wobble while seated. The magazine release is not too hard to press and feels comfortable to operate with a naked or gloved finger. The rail on the GDR-15 is the PTS Centurion Arms CMR rail at a length of 12.5 inches, which also contains a low profile gas block. Be aware this gas block helps keep the CMR rail in place, so make sure you have that sorted during disassembly. The CMR is very lightweight and has multiple slots for quick detach sling attachments and M-lock at the 3, 6 and 9 o'clock positions on the rail. This rail is quite thin, but can quite easily feel bulked up with more attachments applied to it. This rail is definitely a good example of minimalism, without the compromise of customization. However, the balance and weight on the rifle does beg for attachments on the front to help balance it out. The rifle disassembles exactly the same as a real AR rifle, giving access to both the bolt carrier group and, if removed, the hop unit and adjustment screw. Be aware that it is recommended that you disconnect the battery and release the spring in the BCG before separating the receivers. The takedown pins are held by retainers and are initially capable of keeping both receivers from wobbling at all. However, after a heavy amount of usage and fettling, it is likely that the receivers will have a small but unnoticeable amount of wobble between them. The lower receiver houses the trigger mechanism, which controls all the functions of the rifle. The buffer tube houses the recoil buffer and spring, which are held in place by a retaining bar. All the vital parts of the trigger mechanism are made of steel and seem to have little wear after heavy use, which is very good. This does not mean that the GDR-15 doesn't need some maintenance here and there. It is worth making sure that dirt and residue is cleaned off when possible, as friction can lead to slow bolt travel and high battery drainage. The bolt carrier group houses the spring, spring guide, and the loading nozzle. These parts are also reinforced and have had little wear after heavy use. The teeth on the bolt carrier group are met with the gear on the low receiver to pull the BCG back, priming the spring and rechambering another BB from the magazine. The recoil on the GDR-15 is dictated by the speed in which the gear pushes the BCG back, and hence, the faster the action of the bolt, the more recoil the rifle creates. The nozzle head is reinforced and works much like the nozzle in the AG, but at more exaggerated level, loading the BB and expelling the output from the compressed spring in the BCG. The hop unit that connects to the inner and outer barrel is a lot like the expected from a GBBR with an Allen screw. The outer barrel is compatible with WA GBBR aftermarket accessories and can be replaced as such by WA components. The barrel nut is very tightly installed from factory and may require more experienced technician to uninstall. The upper receivers accept most AG spec barrel nuts, allowing for AG aftermarket rail systems to be installed. The inner barrel and hop components are also compatible with AG aftermarket parts as well as PDI components. It seems that access to aftermarket parts is freely available for replacing barrels, rail systems, and internal upgrades for accuracy and range. The magazines for the GDR-15 resemble PTW mags with a sturdy and light structure. Each magazine can hold up to 60 BBs and have been able to sustain rigidity after frequent drops on the ground. The finish on the magazines is a dark grey coat which is susceptible to scratches and oil marks, but has a rough and grippy feel to it. It is uncommon for rifle magazines to have such a rough finish and may be seen as an annoyance to some. Our opinion is that the magazines fit their purpose and look the part, whilst the feel of them may seem rough. They actually feel more functional in wet weather conditions. The DAS GDR-15 shoots at 346 FPS with a variance of 5 FPS at both ends. The consistency of the FPS is quite surprising, considering the amount of moving parts in the system, which means that there is a tight tolerance to how it performs. We have stress tested over 10,000 BBs in this rifle, and have seen no difference in performance from usage. We had noticed that the motor was initially getting warm when we first received the product, but eventually the heating issue resolved itself, as the system has worn in, and it seems that the tolerances have loosened to allow for less friction in the bolt carrier's travel. The GDR-15 is a very accurate AG out of the box, which has initially surprised me. We have tested to see which BB weight is most optimal with this rifle and have concluded that 0.36 or 0.4 gram BBs are most efficient in creating a consistent and range shot with this rifle. We have been able to reach as far as 76 meters without modification of the rifle, with the only disadvantage being the loss of FPS from firing a heavier BB. Accuracy was initially an issue as the hop rubber took time to wear in. However, after the first 100 shots and a roaring feeling in the gut, the rifle started pulling its weight and started getting more consistent shots. The spread of shot at 70 meters was found to be 10 inches, which is very acceptable at that range. The rifle is quite heavy, weighing in at just under 3 kilograms, but has a good balance which makes it more comfortable to use over a period of time. The recoil of the rifle is dependent on the cycling of the bolt, however it is safe to say that it is in between that of a recoil shock AEG and a GBBR. The furniture that is given to the rifle in production has given it more value, and the unique function of this rifle is one of the main reasons for buying this product. The one issue that has been addressed by many is that the trigger is absurdly hard to pull. It is hard to determine the issue, however GBLS has claimed that the 11 pound trigger pull has been proposed to represent that of a mil-spec trigger. There has been speculation as to why the trigger is heavy, however it is one disadvantage that many have addressed. We have personally identified that the trigger is initially too hard to pull, but I've been able to ignore the fact and still be able to rapidly fire the rifle in succession without issue. So, is the GBLS DAS GDR-15 worth it? For the majority of airsoft enthusiasts, no. This is a proprietary and expensive system that has its purpose in creating a reliable and realistic system which works in all weather conditions and can deal with the harsh nature of a harsh environment. this rifle has a place in the community for hardcore enthusiasts of technology, for reenactors, as an alternative to gas-operated replicas, and as a training tool for real-life applications of live firearms. Although the rifle itself is expensive, comparing it to that of a gas equivalent has shown that it is cheaper in the long run, as there are less consumables in the mix of a 5-year period.